My name is Karen Hill, and I'm in Halifax. Today is February the 16th, and we're at the home of Dr. Fred Mackinnon. Dr. Mackinnon has had a long experience in public welfare in Nova Scotia, and I'm wondering if, to begin, Dr. Mackinnon, you could tell us when you were born and where, and a little bit about your early family life.
Well, I was born down in Pictou County, in the eastern part of the county, in a rural area. Actually, my grandfather came there back in 1860. We were a small family, three of us. Four of us, I should say, two brothers and a sister. I had the good fortune to be rather closely involved. Our family had the good fortune to be closely involved with the church, Presbyterian Church. And after church union, I was, 1925, I was born 1912, I would be 13 years old then, in high school. And the United Church minister was very keen that if I was going to university, I should go to Mount Allison. So I'm not sure whether I was fortunate in this or unfortunate, but in any event, I finished grade 11 in a rural school where I grew up and went on to Mount A. I was 15 when I went to Mount A.
You must have been one of the younger students?
Oh, younger. I was much too young to be involved in going to university. One shouldn't go to university at 15. However, I survived the experience. Money was scarce. I suppose money was scarce for everybody in those years, but it was particularly scarce for our family. And the amount of cash income that we saw in a year was very, very small. So going to university was somewhat of a burden for the family and a burden for myself. I stayed out. I entered university, Mount Allison, in 1927, and had 2 years there. And stayed out in 1929-30, taught school for the princely sum of $315 a year in a rural school, which was the current salaries about that time in a one-room rural school. Went back in 1930, in the fall of 1930, and finished university in 1932 in the depth of the Depression.
Mm-hmm.
My mind was somewhat ambivalent at the time as to whether I would teach school, go into teaching. I had taken the specialized course at Mount Allison in teaching. But I'd also honored in mathematics, taken an honors degree in mathematics. And I had high hopes that I might go into the actuarial side of insurance. I began teaching in the fall of 1932 in a two-room rural school at Sunny Bray in Pictou County. And that was for the princely sum of $500 a year, which was a promotion from $315 2 years earlier. The village school in Thorburn in Pictou County became open in the fall of 1933, and I went there as principal, again for a very marked promotion financially, for the sum of $1,500 a year, which was a very good salary in 1933, really. This was a mining town, a labor town, and salaries in the labor centers were always higher than they were in other parts of the province. I taught high school there, or I taught in the high school there, principal of the high school, for 2 years. Believe it or not, we had 75 grade 9, 10, and 11 in the high school. And that's somewhat of a comparison with what is looked upon today as a normal school classroom of 25 or 30 students. But
mm-hmm.
we had 75, with an average attendance somewhere between 50 and 60 in the high school. Well, in the fall of 1935, I had still the dream in mind that I would do graduate work in mathematics, and I went to Harvard. in the fall of 1935 and took a master's degree in mathematics at Harvard and graduated with a master's degree, an AM degree, they call it, in the spring of 1936.
Excuse me, how did it happen that you went to Harvard rather than another school?
Well, I don't know. I can't answer that question other than that I felt that I wanted to get away. I felt that Harvard was prestigious and that a degree from Harvard would be worth more than a degree from one of the local institutions. I can't give you any other reason than that. Mm-hmm. I had no particular ties there or no family ties in Cambridge or Boston that would have meant that I should go there. Well, I came back. I was on leave of absence from the high school in Tarburn. They were expecting me to go back in the fall of 1936 after I'd returned from Harvard. But my desire to get into the actuarial field was even stronger after having a master's degree in mathematics. And I tried every source that I knew that might be available to get into the actuarial field, but it was no go, not in 1935 and 36. And I was approached by the Metropolitan Life to go with them in the field selling. I thought this might be a backdoor entry into the insurance field, into the actuarial field. Well, it didn't turn out that way, because in the sales field in insurance, you're there to move up the ladder in selling, not to move up the ladder and go in the back door into another area. So I stayed with the Metropolitan Life for a year, and I was located in Truro. The Children's Aid Society of Colchester County were looking for, an executive secretary or an executive director in the spring of 1937. And I left the Metropolitan Life and went with the Children's Aid Society of Colchester as executive director. It was a one-man operation. I think there were something in the order of 150 children under care, plus all the other duties and responsibilities that fell on a Children's Aid Society. There's no office there, just an office in the courthouse. Mm-hmm. I knew nothing about it, but it was in the children's field, and I'd got out of the teaching profession, and I wanted to get back into something in this field, and that was available. I didn't really, to be quite honest with you, I didn't know what I was getting into.
Mm-hmm. So it was the feel of being back with children?
Back working with children and back working in the human resource field. But I had no idea what I was getting into, and I had no idea what the end would be. And I didn't know anything about social work. And there's no point in pretending I did.
Uh-huh.
Nothing whatever.
What was it like when you started that job?
Well, in retrospect, you would wonder why you would have the brass or the nerve or the cheek to even undertake something like that. I suppose ignorance would be the only excuse for doing it. You knew so little about it. As I mentioned, there were around 150 kids under care. I was talking to somebody about this the other day. One of the things that was prevalent, the concepts that was prevalent in 1937 and 38 here in Nova Scotia, and I suspect it would have some weight elsewhere in Canada as well, that government didn't have any money. Government had very limited interest in the social welfare field. Child welfare was very low on the totem pole of public esteem, and the whole aim was to do it as cheaply as possible. And the result was that only a very small portion of those children under care were being paid for by government or boarded, that is their board or maintenance being paid for. The urge was all, the direction was all, to get them into free homes. This is well borne out in Ken Bagnall's book, The Little Immigrants, and the Bernardo scheme, where the movement, the whole direction was to get the children out into free homes and thus save money and provide, let's face it, a kind of cheap labor or free labor for the rural areas. And that struck me very early as being one of the iniquitous aspects of the whole business. There were no records, or the records were very, very limited. There was a juvenile court. You were the probation officer of the juvenile court, responsible for all the problems and offenses of juveniles in the area, responsible for the supervision of these 150 children, responsible for all the intake and admission work that was coming from the community in respect to families that were in trouble. And remember, this was in 1937, when the poor relief was at its lowest ebb here in Nova Scotia. The depression was at its worst. Poverty was unbelievable, even in the urban areas, to say nothing of the rural areas. So it was an experience for a year and a half, or so. Mm-hmm. It was an experience of a lifetime.
At that time in Colchester County, was there a poorhouse?
The poorhouse had burned down. The poorhouse at North River had burned down. There were poorhouses in Nova Scotia in practically all of the counties. But it happened that in Colchester County, where I began my career, there was no poorhouse. It had burned down sometime previously, or just about the time I went there.
So what happened to people who were unable to take care of themselves? Oh,
I can't answer that other than to say somehow or other they got by.
Mm-hmm.
They got by. Perhaps friends and relatives were more willing to help in those years. I'm not sure. They got by somehow.
Mm-hmm.
And remember now, Truro, Colchester County was perhaps one of the better off in terms of industry, because there was a Hatton, the Lewis Hatton Cap, Stanfield's factory was located in Truro, and the surrounding country, the surrounding rural area was very prosperous, relatively now. Colchester County has perhaps one of the best farming, agricultural areas in Nova Scotia. So that I was located, situated in one of the best off counties economically in the province, still is.
Mm-hmm.
From an employment point of view, from an agricultural point of view.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that you were in that job for a year and a half.
Yes, the director of child welfare in Halifax in the provincial department at the time was Ernest H. Blois. Blois had a very fascinating career. He began as a school teacher. He graduated from Dal, began as a school teacher towards the end of the 19th century, and eventually went with the old Halifax Industrial School here in Halifax, which was a reformatory, a juvenile reformatory for children under 16 years of age, located out here on Quinpool Road, just off Quinpool Road, in what we now call the Armdale section of Halifax. Blois was the principal. I'm not sure whether there were more than one or two teachers there in the school or not, but in any event, he had the title of principal. And he became very interested and actively involved in matters related to children in trouble, families, and the whole social welfare picture as it was viewed at that time. He was active in the development of the Juvenile Delinquents Act, Federal Juvenile Delinquents Act of 1908. He was involved in the establishment of the Children's Aid Society of Halifax here in Halifax in 1906. He was one of the prime movers in the development of, in the enactment of the first Children's Protection Act in Nova Scotia in 1906. And he had established contact, as I understand it, with J.J. Kelso in Ontario, who was the prime mover of the whole children's aid movement in the province of Ontario. Kelso, by the way, came down here, was brought down here by the IODE in 1905, I believe it was, and Blois was involved in that visit of Kelso here to Nova Scotia.
Mm-hmm.
Blois eventually became the first superintendent of neglected and dependent children in Nova Scotia in 1912, which was Kelso's opposite number in Nova Scotia. And Blois went on, and I mentioned Blois's career because his career was inextricably linked with mine. If it hadn't have been for Blois, I wouldn't have been involved. Blois, after becoming superintendent of neglected and delinquent children, also became involved in the development of juvenile courts, and had a keen interest in retarded children, retarded adults too. was involved in several royal commissions, and eventually became judge of the juvenile court for the city of Halifax around 1924 or 1925. And it's rather interesting from an historical point of view, and rather contradictory also from an historical point of view. Blois held two positions. He was director of child welfare and judge of a juvenile court in the jurisdiction which he covered as director of child welfare. And he held the post of judge of the juvenile court until 1930, when there was a Mother's Allowance Act passed in Nova Scotia, the first Mother's Allowance Act, and he became director of Mother's Allowance, along with the post of director of child welfare. He was involved, I think, secretary, or at least deeply involved, in the Royal Commission that established the Nova Scotia Youth Center in Truro, which was then known as the Nova Scotia Training School for Retired Children. And he was secretary of the board of that particular facility. And in 1933, the government changed, and Angus L. MacDonald, the late Angus L. MacDonald, became premier of Nova Scotia and enacted old age pensions, which was one of the main planks on which the MacDonald government was elected in the fall of 1933. And Blois became director of old age pensions.
As well as the other responsibilities
he had. So he was director of child welfare, director of mother's allowances, director of old age pensions, and secretary of the board of the Nova Scotia Training School in Truro. And when I came in the field in the Children's Aid Society of Colchester in 1937 and came down to Halifax, I was asked, of course, I had only been in the position for a few days or a few weeks when I had a telephone call from this great man in Halifax, Ernest H. Blois, who held these three positions, and asked me to come down and see him. And I came down and spent some time with him. And he was a fascinating character, a fascinating person, 6 foot 3.5 inches tall, weighed 230 or 240 pounds, was a formidable character, both formidable in terms of knowledge and formidable in terms of physical appearance, and formidable in every way that you would want to describe him. Well, for some reason or other, Blois liked to have young people around him. He was very fond of young people, and even though he's, you know, as far as I was concerned, I was scared to death of him. I was only 25 at the time, so it's not too hard to understand. And Blois had only one other senior person with him in the office at the time, an assistant director of old age pensions. And he felt there was a very great need for somebody in the child welfare field to provide leadership and take responsibilities from him in the child welfare field. And I should digress for a moment then into another area that's very important in the development of social welfare in Nova Scotia. The first Department of Health was established in Nova Scotia, I should think around 1930 or 1931, under the Rhodes-Harrington government, which was a conservative government. Dr. George Murphy was the first Minister of Health. From the very earliest days, and I have not researched how the Rockefeller Foundation became involved, but from the very earliest days, the Rockefeller Foundation had been involved in the development of health services in Nova Scotia. The Rockefeller Foundation, as you know, put a tremendous amount of money into the development of public health resources and facilities all over the world, particularly in what one would call underprivileged or underdeveloped areas. And Nova Scotia was looked upon as an underdeveloped area. And the first public health resource here was financed almost entirely by the Rockefeller Foundation. And the Rockefeller Foundation made sizable grants to the development of the Dalhousie Medical School and to other resources and facilities related to public health, the development of public health at Dalhousie. Well, when Dr. Frank Davis, became Minister of Health in the MacDonald government in 1933, he had a very close liaison and tie-in with the Rockefeller Foundation and the medical personnel in the Rockefeller Foundation. Mr. Blois approached me in the winter of 1938, about joining the department as perhaps assistant director of child welfare or in some capacity such as that to promote the child welfare program. And he felt that it was highly desirable that I should spend some time traveling across Canada, seeing what was being done elsewhere. There was no thought or idea about social work education, or social work, formal social work education. Blois was not a medical man. Davis was. And Davis had this tie-in with the Rockefeller Foundation. Davis discussed it with the Rockefeller people. And the Rockefeller people, of course, felt that if I was to become involved, there was no reason at all why there shouldn't be some kind of formal training. And if there was formal training, it should be in a school of social work. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm skipping over a lot of details here in order to get to the nub of the matter. Mm-hmm. But it ended up that in September 1938, I was admitted to the University of Chicago School of Social Service Administration under the tutelage and benign influence of the Abbots, Grace and Edith Abbott and Sophonisba Breckinridge and all of that group of giants in the United States that had tie-ins with the Children's Bureau and with the New Deal, the developing New Deal in Washington. Mm-hmm. And it was an exciting, fascinating experience, and so, you know, for me, mm-hmm. Because it opened up a whole new world, a completely new world to me. It was social work at its best, with the emphasis on public welfare, mm-hmm. and on government, and on the role government could play in the development of a just society.
Mm-hmm. It must have been a new world for you in several different ways. Chicago being somewhat more urban than.
Oh yes. Also, I had a year of graduate work already in Cambridge, and I had become accustomed to what I might expect. As a matter of fact, to be quite honest with you, after the year of slave labor that I had put in at the at Harvard, it was fun and games. Social science study was fun and games, I can assure you.
What kinds of courses did you take there?
Well, the emphasis was, of course, on public welfare, The Child in the State with Grace Abbott. Grace Abbott, those two books that she wrote, The Child in the State, Volume 1 and Volume 2, she taught that course, mm-hmm. out of those books, taught directly from the books that she'd written. She had just come back from Washington, from the Children's Bureau in Washington. Edith had written a book on public assistance, and she had taught a course on public assistance, the rudiments of public assistance. I've forgotten the name of the chap that did a course on social insurance. Paul Douglas, who later became Senator Paul Douglas, taught a course. He wasn't in the School of Social Work, he was in the Graduate School of Political Science. Taught a course on labor economics and labor problems and so on. Psychiatry and social work. Ethel Very was one of the outstanding figures in Chicago at the time. Ethel taught a course in child placement, foster placement of kids and so on, institutional care. Grace Browning, I think, who was at the University of Toronto later, and Grace wrote a book on casework. Grace did the casework. And there was also a course on social investigation, social research, mm-hmm. and that kind of thing. It was a very broad. Mm-hmm. It was a very broad curriculum, mm-hmm. and I did my casework. I did my field work at Chicago Southwest. Again, it was. Remember, this was 1938. The Depression was still at its height in the United States. In the old Chicago Relief Agency, and it was in the city of Chicago is where I did my field work.
So when you say Chicago Southwest, that was the District of Chicago?
That was the district of the Chicago Relief Agency. Mm-hmm. First part of my field work I did there, and then did the latter part of it at the Chicago Orphan. What? Chicago, the Chicago Orphans Asylum, of all places, which was a very, very excellent facility for children in trouble.
Mm-hmm. What did you do there?
Well, carrying a small caseload of kids, children, mm-hmm. working with children. So I came back from Chicago on December 4, the latter part of that, I spent the fall semester, the winter semester, the spring semester, and the summer semester, four semesters, I left Chicago, I should think, about the end of August, or, yes, the end of August, 1939. And the latter part of the fellowship that I had had from the Rockefeller Foundation, I spent in the western United States, and then I visited every province in Canada and spent a week, 10 days, a couple of weeks at each of the places, Vancouver, Victoria, Edmonton, Regina, and so on, right across. Ontario, I spent, I think, 2 weeks in Toronto. Saw most of the facilities for the retarded across the country. And back down into the United States to Washington, spent some time in Washington, and back home, and I came here, back here, on December 4th, 1939. And I've been here ever since, with the exception of 3 or 4 months that I spent with the Canadian Welfare Council in Ottawa.
In Ottawa. So you began work formally then as Assistant Director of Child Welfare in late 1939?
That's December 4th, 1939.
Started right away, no holiday?
No holidays, no, it was back to work.
Having had the experience of the education, along with your experience at the Children's Aid Society, and then the benefits of travel across North America, when you began that job, what did you hope to do?
Well, I came back, when I came back in 1939, I didn't know what I was getting into. Needless to say, I didn't have a full grasp of what the department was like, what here in Halifax. Remember, I was operating in Truro, 60 miles distant, and I might have been in the course of my year in Truro, or a year and 3 or 4 months, I might have been in the department maybe 4 or 5 times, and that was only for an hour or two for a discussion with Mr. Blois, the gray eminence of the department, and I didn't know what was going on in the department. I guess I came back thinking that I was going to, you know, change everything overnight and reform the world in a hurry. It didn't work out that way, and I soon had my views changed on that. I think the main thing that I can say about my attitude, my point of view when I came back, that I believed intensely in the role of government in creating a better world, that government could create a better world, a more just society. I believe that implicitly. My views have undergone some transformation on that, mm-hmm. needless to say, in the last 30 or 40 years. I'm not quite as optimistic about that now as I was then. About government now.
Yes. Yeah.
Be able to do it.
I'll be anxious to talk with you about that in a bit. At the time that you came back in 1939, had the report from Britain come out yet, the Beveridge Report?
The Beveridge Report, no, that was later. The Beveridge Report would have come out, I should think, around 1941, 42.
And at the time that you came back, the Royal Sirwa Commission...
The Royal Sirwa Commission had just... it had just reported, or was in the process of reporting. That was very much in the forefront.
Did that have any impact on your hopes?
Yes, it had some impact on my hopes, but I was pretty far removed from the impact of the Royal Sirwa Commission at that stage. Later on it did, but not at that stage. I found myself immersed almost immediately in the nuts and bolts of the child welfare program. Mm-hmm. And it was so overpowering. There was so little being done, so many things to do, that for three or four years, all of my energy and all of my time and thought and everything else was devoted to that. So that I didn't, until, I think it's fairly safe to say, until 1943 or 44, I didn't begin to get up from under the load that I was carrying there to think about the larger issues of Canadian issues or federal government issues or federal government relationships. And Blois, remember, was a powerful figure, a strong figure, and he carried that and made the decisions and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Remember now, this was a time of when of administrators were not as democratic and sharing as they are today. You had leaders who exerted authority and power, and they used it.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't share it too much with other people around them.
What was your job then? What did you do?
Well, my job was largely, there were 12 children's aid societies in the province. My job was to try to assist them, help them. There were a multitude of things to be done in terms of improving their staffing, improving their financing, improving their record keeping, and attempting to get better legislation. Mm-hmm. I think, looking back and trying to analyze what happened, I think my first commitment was to try to improve the personnel.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we started. And we tried. I tried to start where we were, and that was pretty primitive. We had, I think, six professional social workers in Nova Scotia when I came here.
Mm-hmm.
That is, they were members of the CASW. We had Elizabeth Torrey, who was executive director of the Children's Aid Society in Cape Breton. We had Miss Fulton, who was involved with the old Dependents Board of Trustees. Mm-hmm. That was providing grants for the families of the soldiers that were overseas.
Mm-hmm.
We had Ada Ward, who was with the YWCA here. Gwen Lance, who was executive director of the Children's Aid Society of Halifax. And very shortly after I came here, we brought Phyllis McDougall down from Toronto. She was a native-born Nova Scotian. She was working with the Children's Aid, well, I think the Children's Aid Society of Toronto, or if not, it was the Neighborhood Services in Toronto, but anyway, then she'd working in Toronto. We brought her back, and the first CASW branch that we had in Nova Scotia, that was the membership,
mm-hmm.
myself and five others. So that the first challenge here was to try to do something on personnel, because there was no hope. There was no hope at all of improving anything or going anywhere, or at least I felt a deep conviction about this, unless I improved the personnel.
Mm-hmm.
So my nose was to that grindstone, and that was the first effort that we made. And we brought in all kinds of people, like Nora Lee, who was with the assistant director at the Canadian Welfare Council. We brought in people from Ontario to conduct staff training sessions, workshops, seminars. And I suppose the most important step that we took was in 1941, we began to develop the Maritime School of Social Work.
Mm-hmm.
The Maritime School of Social Work in 1941 was a private effort, not associated with any single university, but we had a loose affiliation with St. of X, St. Francis Xavier and Antigonish, with St. Mary's, Mount St. Vincent and Acadia, and Mount Allison. Dalhousie, for one reason or another, we had no affiliation, no linkage with Dalhousie, whatever.
Hmm.
And the Maritime School of Social Work, I lectured at the Maritime School from 1941 on through until 1970, and was involved with it in a variety of ways as secretary of the board, as treasurer for a time, as vice chairman for a time, mm-hmm. and as a lecturer at the school.
Mm-hmm. How did one go about getting a school of social work started in those days?
Faith, hope, charity. Mostly charity.
Now that we know where the funding came from.
we worked on it. We developed on a shoestring, to be quite honest with you. And we existed on a shoestring for the first 8 or 9 years. Very limited funding. The universities helped us, believe it or not. The universities with which we were affiliated helped us. We got some small government grants. But it was very limited financing and hard going, hard
mm-hmm.
sledding.
Mm-hmm. What kind of a certificate or paper or degree would people come out of that?
They had a certificate in social work for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
It was, and now I can't give you the date, but eventually we made an arrangement with the affiliated universities. I should think it would be about 1950, around 1949 or 1950. And the arrangement was that having completed the 2 years at the Maritime School of Social Work And the Maritime School, having attested to that fact, that they had completed 2 years of work satisfactorily, then we made an arrangement with Mount Allison, with Acadia, St. Francis Xavier, and St. Mary's, that they would grant the master's degree. Mm-hmm. And so from that point on, from 48 or 49 or whenever it was, the master's degree was granted for the successful completion of the 2 years' work at the Maritime School. All that time, we were negotiating with Dalhousie for a takeover by Dalhousie. But again, it's hard to realize in this time, in this day of ecumenical conciliation between Roman Catholic and Protestant, it's hard to realize that that was one of the central issues in those early days, because Dalhousie was started as a Presbyterian by the Presbyterians. And I suspect, in the early part of this century, most of our Roman Catholic friends looked upon Dalhousie as either non-sectarian or Protestant, mm-hmm. in origin, at least. And certainly there was a feeling on part of the establishment that I was involved with here, that if the school affiliated with Dalhousie, then this would mean another Roman Catholic school, perhaps at St. Mary's or St. X. And that was unthinkable.
Unthinkable. I'm not clear on that. If the Maritime School affiliated with Dalhousie, then there would have to be another.
Our Catholic friends would feel you have now become a denominational school at Dalhousie. We're going to have a school of our own at St. Francis Xavier or St. Mm-hmm. Mary's.
Okay.
And from the point of view of the future and planning, good social planning, this was unthinkable, wholly unacceptable. So we had to plan strategically and stick handle in such a way that that wouldn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
And most of our energy in the 40s, in the late 40s and 50s, was devoted to ways and means of keeping the community coordinated and cohesive and not split apart on a religious basis. Now, eventually, the union or amalgamation or whatever you want to call it with Dalhousie was effected without any problem or any difficulty. It came about, I should think, in the late 60s. That the school became an integral part of Dalhousie University. But remember, by that time, the public mood had changed very drastically all over Canada, and it changed very drastically here.
Mm-hmm.
So that we were much more inclined to get along with each other and trust each other.
Over a period of 20 years, that kind of trust developed.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we had done it in the 50s, I don't think we would have got away with it. I think we would have had two schools.
Mm-hmm. It's a testimony to patience, I think.
It's no question about it.
Yeah.
No question about it.
During the time that you were assistant director of child welfare, did the work of your own department change?
I referred to the emphasis that we had put on the development of personnel and the development of the Maritime School as an outgrowth of that or as an adjunct of that. Curiously enough, one of the outside influences that affected child welfare in Nova Scotia more than anything else I know was the movement of British guest children here in 1940 and 41, This is little is known about this, but it had a tremendous effect on the status of the child welfare program,
mm-hmm.
on the status of the department as it was developing then. Now remember, it wasn't a department of social welfare or a department of social services in 1940. It was an adjunct to the Department of Health.
Mm-hmm.
There was no deputy minister of health. There was no deputy minister of social services or public welfare. Blois was referred to by all these titles that I've just given to you. Eventually he became, occasionally he was referred to as the chief welfare officer for the province.
Mm-hmm.
And his opposite number in health was referred to as the chief health officer.
Mm-hmm.
But it was not until 1944 that the title of deputy minister was bestowed on Blois. He became deputy minister of a coordinated department, and his opposite number, Peter Campbell, became deputy minister of health. Mm-hmm. But the British guest children came to Canada, began to come to Canada from the northeast coast of England that was most heavily bombed in the early years of the war. And I think somewhere in the vicinity of there were more than 4,000 children came altogether, but somewhere in the vicinity of 1,800 children came to Canada, and as I recall the number, about 150 of those came to Nova Scotia. Now you may ask the question and wonder, why would this have any effect on Nova Scotia child welfare? Well, it had a number of effects. Number one, when a visitor comes to your house, you're always more willing to put forward the best foot and have everything spick and span and have the best tablecloth and the best meal on the table. And so the province, politically, financially, and in every way, put its best foot forward to do an outstanding job for this group of children that were coming to Nova Scotia in terms of placement. So it meant that for the first time, we got money. We were given resources. We were given facilities to do a relatively good job of child placement, of selecting foster homes, of visiting foster homes, establishing contact with prospective foster parents, and of matching the 150 children that came in to the homes that we had waiting here in Nova Scotia. Mm-hmm. So we were able to demonstrate system, a good system, a professional system, for the first time. Mm-hmm. And we had the know-how to do it. It's not much use to have the know-how if you don't have the resources. We were given the resources to do it. And not only did it demonstrate what could be done, but most of the kids were placed strategically throughout the province. And they were placed in homes with people that had a very great influence on public opinion. And the department became known. And the child welfare system became known throughout the province. And I would think from a public relations point of view, that's the external aspect of it. And from the internal point of view, the system itself, the management of the system, we gained immeasurably by that, mm-hmm. in status, in prestige, in public estimation, and so on. We did a good job with it. Mm-hmm. We did a fantastic job with it. Mm-hmm. And the kids went back in 1945, the end of the war. There were no hitches, no problems, no difficulties, no scandals. It was just one of those good things that happened to us.
Mm-hmm. Something that you and Mr. Blois were able to use to good advantage.
That's right. We used it to good advantage.
Yeah. You moved on then a little later.
Well, in 1940, we brought George Davidson. You referred to the Royal Sirwa Report. R. McGregor Dawson, who was a professor of political science at the University of Toronto, was brought in by the Macdonald government to do a study of the economic prospects in Nova Scotia. We were simply doing what the federal government was doing with the Marsh Report, and the John Bracken was doing with the Dawn of Charlotte Whitton and the Dawn of Ampler Life, and all of the other reports, the Beveridge Report in Great Britain. Dawson was brought in here to do a study of the economic prospects for Nova Scotia in the post-war years. Mm-hmm. And Davis, again referring back to Davis, who was very progressive and visionary and forward-looking, decided that it was important that we should have somebody take a look-see at the social services in Nova Scotia. The Rockefeller people were brought in to do the public health aspect of it, mm-hmm. his friends in the Rockefeller Foundation. So Davis came to us and said, now who are we going to get? Well, by that time I had gotten to know George Davidson. George was, as you know, graduated from Harvard in classics and came out to British Columbia and was director of Mother's Allowances in British Columbia. And there was a Liberal government in British Columbia and a Liberal government in Mackenzie King, and George was brought in to the Department of Immigration to work with Blair in respect to the British guest children. And from there, he went from the working with the British guest children in 1941. He went with the and I met him. That's when I first met him, in connection with the British guest children. George went to the Canadian Welfare Council as executive director. And when Davis said, "Now, who do you want?" The obvious person was Davidson. He was with the Canadian Welfare Council. He was in a position where he could bring knowledge of what was happening in BC and elsewhere in Canada and Nova Scotia. And Davidson did a very excellent report, I believe around 1943, a very excellent report on welfare services in Nova Scotia, which was a kind of a blueprint for everything that happened afterwards. Now, George made the comment that if you were going to do a good survey, you should do it on the same basis as you do casework. You start where people are, and you find out what people want to do, and then you try to verbalize what they want, so that you have a blueprint that's practical, not a blueprint that's visionary and somewhere away up here, but a blueprint that's practical from the point of view of the people that you're giving the blueprint to. And George gave us a blueprint, which was very largely the result of discussions with myself and Blois and others about where we felt we could take the department in the years ahead. Mm-hmm. And it was a very very excellent exercise. And I think one of the few Royal Commission reports that had been implemented over a period of time. I think by 1960 it was entirely implemented in its entirety.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that had a very great effect. Now, one of the effects that it had was in, April 1944, the Department of Public Welfare was created. Blois became the first deputy minister of the Department of Public Welfare, and I became director of child welfare. And Department of Health was created at the same time. Now, the Minister of Public Health continued to be the Minister of Public Welfare until 1957. But it gave system and form and order to what we were doing that we didn't have before. We mm-hmm. went on from there.
Mm-hmm.
Blois stayed with the department until 1946 when he retired. In 46, my confrere, Mr. Farquhar, H.S. Farquhar, who was director of old age pensions, had been appointed at the same time I was. He had been assistant director of old age pensions, then was appointed director of old age pensions when I was appointed director of child welfare. The government found it very difficult to make a decision as to who should be deputy minister. And I was the junior, many, many years the junior of Mr. Farquhar. He had gone to the department in 1933. I didn't go there until 1939. And as governments do in that kind of situation, they decided they wouldn't do anything, and they appointed both of us deputy heads. So we had a kind of a two-headed monster from 1947 until 1959, when eventually, under the Stanfield government, I was appointed deputy minister.
Uh-huh.
And the two-headed monster was resolved with my appointment in 59.
So what was your title then from 47 on?
We were deputy heads. We held these other... For legal purposes, I was director of child welfare,
mm-hmm.
and eventually director of social assistance and mother's allowances, director of child welfare and director of mother's allowances, and eventually director of social assistance. But for purposes of reporting, I reported to the minister as a deputy head.
Mm-hmm. During that time, from 1944 to 1959, a number of changes came about in the department itself, I guess. I wonder if you could describe some of the changes that happened.
Well, I mentioned personnel. I think if I were to single out any one thing of which I was most proud during those years and which I gave most effort to, it would be in the area of personnel and the development of personnel. The second push that we had to make was to improve the social legislation. We had an illegitimate Children's Act going back to the turn of the century, an Adoption Act which was rather primitive, a Poor Relief Act which remained essentially the same back to 1758 when it had been enacted. Minor changes, but no, they were cosmetic changes, nothing major. So that a great deal of my effort from 1944 on was aimed at developing a climate to effect change in those areas. One of the most interesting, perhaps, one of the most interesting chapters related to the Adoption Act. Very early in the war years, because of the inadequacies of the provincial legislation, the lack of provincial services for unmarried mothers, and the loopholes in the Adoption Act, a baby farm had developed here at East Chester, the ideal maternity home at East Chester. It's a fascinating chapter.
What's a baby farm?
Well, it's a place where you take in unmarried mothers and look after them during their prenatal period. They have their babies, and then you place the baby for adoption. And you probably collect some funds along the way.
Who were they run by?
Private, for profit. Nothing to do with government, unlicensed, privately operated for profit. The baby farms, I suspect, were not uncommon in other provinces, in Ontario and Alberta, and other parts of Canada. I know they, at least that they were reported in the newspaper. It was a very excellent way to make money, because I'm sure you're aware of the fact that Americans, and not only Americans, but Canadians and South Americans and people from other countries were starving for children. There was a shortage of children for adoption, and they would pay anything within reason to get a child for adoption. Mm-hmm. So it'd be nothing unusual for $500, $1,000, a couple of $1,000 to change hands in order to see your child.
And so how was it?
The ideal maternity home at East Chester eventually, by 1946 or 47, had 125 children in cribs. And we're not talking about something in the order of 10 children or 15 children. It was a major enterprise. And we struggled with that on our doorstep. We developed legislation, the Maternity and Boarding Homes Act, I think in 1945. But it was like a flea, like a fly attacking an elephant. It was of no value at all. We brought them to court. We fined them. But, you know, if you're doing well otherwise, what's a $25 or a $50 fine? It's just a nuisance, that's all.
How did the issue get on the doorstep of the department?
How did it get on the doorstep of the department? It was an eyesore in the community, and people were reporting it from all sides, and children were being placed, and we knew they were being placed in situations that were that were not good around the province, not desirable, and they were being placed out of the province, and complaints were coming to us from all sources.
I know that in some provinces, children were gladly placed in other provinces and in the United States.
But hopefully if it was done, it would be done with some degree of protection, for the home in which they were being placed would have been studied beforehand by some authority where they were being placed. There was no study or anything like that involved with this. This was simply, I would come in and say I wanted a child, and I would be asked a few questions, and if I could produce a bank account or some paper qualifications, I would have a child, go home with a child.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There was no such thing as a study being done at my home. Mm-hmm. No such thing as having the Child Welfare Authority in Washington or Wyoming or wherever it might be, look into the situation in advance and make a report that, you know,
mm-hmm.
think of, thought of. Well, eventually, to get to the bottom line on the story, what happened was, The Montreal Standard was a well-known weekly newspaper at the time. There was a young chap from Nova Scotia here by the name of, it's immaterial. But in any event, he was writing for the Montreal Standard from this area, and he decided to do an article on the ideal maternity home. He interviewed me and a number of other people, and there appeared in the Montreal Standard in the centerfold, and this was a large newspaper, you know, full-size newspaper, there appeared pictures and two-page spread in the centerfold, and under the heading, Babies for Sale in Nova Scotia. Now, this caused a furor right across the country. It was a scandalous thing for the province to have this, Babies for Sale in Nova Scotia. The content of the article was extremely critical, disclosed the whole operation. And they made a very fatal mistake. They sued the Standard for libel.
Who did?
The Ideal Maternity Home sued the Standard for libel, believing that they could succeed in a libel suit, that the article was scurrilous, that it was libelous, that it wasn't true. And again, to make a long story short, they lost the suit. And they were simply, you know, I'm omitting all the detail here, and there were 3 weeks of court hearings, and it was a very interesting story. But they were literally laughed out of business. They went bankrupt about a year or two later and went out of business. What with an adverse public opinion, which had been developed during the court hearings, adverse publicity, the fact that the government had stiffened its back because of the criticism that it received across the country, and the totality of things that happened, they were simply put out of business.
Mm-hmm.
For example, one of the headlines in the newspaper, to give you some idea, you know, of the power of the press and the media in this kind of situation, how powerful it can be as compared with the power of government. The two lawyers defending the Montreal Standard were very capable, able lawyers. And one of them, Mr. Potter from Lunenburg County, was in charge of getting the evidence. And he was drawing out the proprietor and asking questions very, very smooth and easy, and leading her on, so on, and saying, you know, I suppose children died on occasion. Yes, some of the children were born dead, and sometimes they were, something happened shortly after birth, and so on. And how did you handle that kind of situation? What did you do? Well, they had a burial ground for the children, and it was out back of the home, yes, and so on, and they had a funeral service, and they had church service for them, and they were all buried properly, and so on. Mm-hmm. And he went on and brought it out, and so on. And what now? What about an undertaker? Would you have an undertaker there? And well, no, they didn't have an undertaker there. That they felt that was unnecessary under the circumstances, since, you know, they would have a religious service over the children. And did you have a coffin or a casket? No, they didn't. They bought their butter in boxes and so on, and they used the butter boxes for the coffins for the children. They lined it with silk and so on. So the paper came out the next day with a huge headline, Babies Buried in Butter Boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, need I tell you, you know, what kind of effect that would have? Buried in Butter Boxes.
That would indeed be the bottom line at the end of that story,
that was
wouldn't
the
it?
The end of the bottom line of that story. That was the kind of thing that happened. That's only one. That was the most dramatic of the incidents that happened in connection with the hearing.
I want to ask you another question about again, that period of time, and this will probably be the final question during your time from 1944 to 1959. The other thing that happened during that period of time was the replacement of the Poor Relief Act.
That came after. The Poor Relief Act was not, that's a story in itself, 1958.
Take a break and talk about it later, or would you prefer to finish up on it now?
No, I think that probably we better take a break.
Why don't we just stop then and
all right.
talk about it
Good.
Later?
Fine.
To resume our interview, Dr. Mackinnon, I wonder if we might talk for a few minutes about what happened in Nova Scotia from about 1955 on. The Poor Relief Act was replaced, and the county home system was reorganized. Could you tell us how that came about?
Well, I mentioned earlier that one of the primary concerns, as far as I was concerned, was the social legislation structure, the reform of the rather archaic Illegitimate Children's Act into a more modern Unmarried Parents Act, the design of a more modern Adoption Act, and of course the Children's Protection Act was constantly under review and revision, concerned as it was with children's aid societies and the supervision of children. But underlying and overriding all of this was the poor law, because I think from a social welfare point of view, it's quite impossible to have a good social welfare structure unless you have a good public assistance structure at the provincial level. And we didn't have that. We never had it until, we didn't have it until 1958, when the poor law was finally put out of its misery and we began to develop a modern Social Assistance Act. It was a long, slow, painful, difficult process, let me tell you. I think if you were to ask, if you were to raise the question, how was it achieved? I think there were two central reasons for finally getting it, having it done away with. One, from the very first time that I went into the department, from 1939 on, I became convinced that one of the things we had to do was to develop credibility. We didn't have it. We didn't have status. We didn't have credibility. I don't think that you can, I don't think that you can persuade legislators and legislatures to do things, to make changes, to become involved in social reform, unless you have credibility. So that very early in the game, I began to establish, to try to develop credibility for the department as a whole, for the personnel in the department, that we were dependable, we were reliable, we were efficient, and we were doing a good job. And we were doing a better job than any other government department. That kind of pride, that kind of esprit de corps, that kind of morale to build up within the department. I felt it was essential. I unashamedly used the Adoption Act in my contact with lawyers. At that time, there weren't as many lawyers in the province as there are now, but I went out of my way to develop public relations with the legal profession, whom we met in the course of our working together under the Adoption Act. And 75%, as you must know, of the members of the Legislative Assembly in Canada are lawyers. So that it was a good thing to get to know the lawyers, because eventually they became members of the Legislative Assembly. And it's the old story, you know, be kind to your caseworker because someday he may be your boss. And in this particular case, the lawyers that we cultivated and worked with at the grassroots level eventually got into the Legislative Assembly. And I went out of my way, and I say it unashamedly, I went out of my way to cultivate the members of the Legislative Assembly. Liberal and conservative, and NDP, and all sides, to try to create the atmosphere that we were efficient and we were credible, believing that that was the only way that we could ever achieve reform. Now that was one of the routes that was the major route, I think, that we took. The second route, of course, was to work with the private agencies, the Council of Social Agencies here in Halifax, the voluntary organization, with the boards of the children's aid societies, and constantly, like the dripping of water on stone, create get the idea across that this had to be changed. It meant money. It meant a lot of money. And Nova Scotia, in the Depression years and in the first of the post-war years, didn't have money. We didn't have the revenues. We didn't begin to come into our own revenue-wise until well on in the 50s. And actually, the Stanfield-Smith government, the Stanfield government in 1956, was the first government that began to move into an era when there was money, some money, and of course the lucrative years of the 60s when there was money to do a lot of things. What was the blow that finally killed father, so to speak? Well, in 1956, and I understand Bessie Toussaint was involved in this, and was a member of the delegation that went to Ottawa to wait on Louis Saint-Laurent, who was prime minister at the time. As I understand it, and as I've heard the story, there was a bit of a recession in Canada. Naturally, it hit the central Canada harder and earlier than it hit us down here. And they went to Ottawa to press upon the prime minister the need for some kind of public assistance legislation, cost sharing. Because remember, the Rolls Zero Report came out flatly against grants and aid to the provinces. And although that had been downplayed in the various reports during the 40s, the conventional wisdom in a lot of quarters was that it was unwise to make money available to the provinces. Well, to make a long story short, the Saint-Laurent government enacted the Unemployment Assistance Act of 1955. I think it became operative on January 1st, 1956. That was the first, apart from the old unemployment relief grants that had been made to the municipalities in the Depression years, that was the first of the first federal cost-sharing program in public assistance. Now, it was limited, extremely limited. It had, I don't know who dreamed this up, but it was somebody dreamed it up. I think George Davidson was the perpetrator of it. There was a 0.45 threshold in it. And the 0.45 threshold was an attempt, statistically or arithmetically, to get around this problem of the unemployables in Canada. Because the federal government by that time had accepted through unemployment insurance, had accepted total responsibility for unemployment insurance and for creating full employment conditions. But the provinces were to be responsible for the unemployables. Well, how could you on a case-by-case basis determine who was employable and who was unemployable? And by 1956, it became clearly evident you couldn't do it. Administratively speaking, it was an impractical thing to expect. So Davidson, I think, was the one who dreamed up the idea, we'll have a statistical determination. And the statistical determination was that 0.45% on the average, by and large, represents the number of unemployed people in a province. And when the public assistance caseloads exceeds 0.45%, then you're in a cost-shareable situation, but not until it exceeds 0.45%. Well, we were so far down on the line in Nova Scotia that we didn't have 0.45% of the population getting assistance. Now, you can say, well, then you must have been in a very fortunate position. Well, that wasn't the case at all. It was simply that our people were being starved. And over and over and over again, I had personally seen cases of children coming before the courts ostensibly on charges of neglect, which you didn't need to have very much intelligence or do very much scouting around to realize that the real reason why they were before the court was not that the parents were neglecting them, it's the parents didn't have money to look after them. They were poor. So, Nova Scotia couldn't qualify. That was in 1956, and as you must know, the election came in 1957. The Diefenbaker government was elected. And very shortly after the Diefenbaker government was elected, Monteith was the Minister of National Health and Welfare. And I'll not go into all the, this would be a story that would take a half an hour to tell you how it happened. But in any event, the bottom line was that the 0.45 threshold was removed. And the federal government began to cost share from the first dollar expenditure of assistance, of general assistance. Mm-hmm. And I can very vividly recall the situation because I was in Ottawa at the time attending a federal-provincial conference. The Premier, the Honorable Robert Stanfield, was there, and his lieutenant, G.I. Smith, who was Minister of Highways, but he was really the Premier's strong right arm. And I managed to arrange a breakfast meeting with Mr. Stanfield and Mr. Smith. And I pointed out to them that this was something that had needed to be done. They must know that it had needed to be done for years and years and years, and here was a golden opportunity. The federal government were coming in now with a cost-sharing program where 50 cents on the dollar for all relief and assistance expenditures would be financed by the federal government. And to make a long story short, in 1958, we were able to dispense with the Poor Relief Act and make the first beginnings of a Social Assistance Act cost-shared with the federal government. Now, needless to say, we didn't develop overnight. It was not until 7 years later with the Canada Assistance Plan that we began to come into our own, and with the affluence, which was a part of the 60s, we began to come into our own in respect to the development of a modern public assistance, social assistance legislation. We had, of course, these poorhouses. I'm not sure how many of them there were. There were at least a dozen strategically located around the province in counties, on a county basis. They were horrible places. No other way to describe them. I don't think that we had more than maybe 10 good nursing homes or homes for the aged. And these were all under private auspices. The county homes or poor houses or poor farms, as they were called, were simply not places which any person with any dignity or respectability would want their father or mother or a member of their family to go. You went there because you had no other choice, because there was nothing else available for you. You couldn't make any other plan. For example, give you an illustration of it. I recall going down to West Hants to visit the poor farm there, and the first invitation I had was to go out and see the horses and the cattle and the cows. They were much more interested in the animals on the farm, which was an adjunct always of the county home, than they were with the guests, or as they call them, the inmates in the county home. I remember going in 1958 down to Shelburne, along with Mr. Farquhar, who was my confrere in the department at the time, and the bread was being bought from a bakery in Shelburne. They bought the week-old moldy bread. That's what they fed to the guests, the mold of the bread, literally covered with green mold. Mm-hmm. To make matters worse, back in the late 19th century, around 1880 or 1890, the superintendent of the Nova Scotia Hospital developed the idea that there should be cottage hospitals for the mentally ill. And we developed in Nova Scotia a number of municipal hospitals. Now, the idea was excellent if they had been properly financed and properly supervised, but they weren't. And so these municipal hospitals grew up contiguous to, adjacent to, the poor farms, with no professional or sophisticated admission system. And so you got the kind of situation that Joe Howe described here, you know, where you had the poor, the lame, the decrepit, the blind, the unmarried mother, the children. You had a mix of almost every conceivable kind of aspect of humanity in these facilities mm-hmm. by 1958. Now, I suppose that it reached its zenith in the 20s, in the late 20s, because the Mother's Allowance Act and the Old Age Pension Act and the various pieces of social legislation which came on the scene in the 30s and the 40s had some ameliorating influence on it. So that when I saw it in the 40s and 50s, it was not at its worst. I should think it reached its peak around the late 20s. Mm-hmm. But it was bad, you know, if it was worse in the 20s, I wouldn't want to have seen it because it was bad enough. Gradually, one by one, and again, that didn't happen overnight. One by one, they closed up. What really got us going here on decent facilities, respectable, decent, dignified facilities for the aged in terms of nursing homes, was the Central Mortgage and Housing Corporation. Because around 1963 or 1964, CMHC developed a social policy or legislation to the effect that hostel-type accommodation, that's nursing home-type accommodation, would be financed by Central Mortgage and Housing Corporation on a 40-year term at a low subsidized interest rate. And one by one, the various groups began to take this up, including municipal government. And we now have in Nova Scotia, and that began about 1965, we now have, we had by 1980 when I left the department, we had one of the better nursing home systems in Canada, mm-hmm. in that's been developed in that 15-year period with the cooperation of the federal government, mm-hmm. Central Mortgage and Housing Corporation, and the Nova Scotia Housing Commission and our own department.
And so through that kind of cooperation and over a period of time, with the foundation of a new Social Assistance Act, the county poorhouses were phased out.
Were phased out completely. Yeah. We have gone in two directions here that New Brunswick has chosen not to take. Direction number one, we have consistently emphasized the importance of the private voluntary agency, and we've maintained our Children's Aid Society structure. New Brunswick, as a result of the Byrne Commission report some years ago, have done away totally, completely with Children's Aid Societies and have made that an integral part of the public welfare, the social welfare program, mm-hmm. under the provincial aegis. Mm-hmm. We have not taken that route. Secondly, New Brunswick did away with municipal responsibility for public assistance. Again, we have not gone that route. We're following pretty much in the footsteps of Ontario in maintaining a very strong municipal presence in social assistance. And so the past 15 or 20 years has been the provincial direction, the provincial responsibility has been very largely aimed at setting standards, working with, cooperating with the municipal level of government, which is the basic authority now for the granting of residual assistance. Residual assistance being that assistance caseload which is left after provincial assistance does its job. Mm-hmm. And the provincial assistance program is confined mainly to, well, to mothers with children, that whole group of mothers who are widows, mothers whose husbands are disabled, dead, mothers whose husbands are in penitentiary, and disabled persons.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The Social Assistance Act was proclaimed, I believe, in 1958, and shortly thereafter you changed jobs.
Well, in 1950, in April 1959, I was appointed deputy minister. Because of the fact that I referred to earlier that there were two deputy heads, there had been no concerted attempt to build up what I would describe as a generalized field service or a unified field service, which had been the rule in British Columbia and many of the western provinces, set the example. And one of the challenges that was laid on my doorstep in 1959 when I took over as deputy minister was to unify the field service and try to put a generalized, unified field service together. And that was consistent with the direction that I had been taking from 1940 on, where I'd said earlier that I felt that if we were to achieve anything in the province, it had to be on the basis of a highly qualified, a highly efficient, and staff of, with a, at least a cadre, a core of professional, of professionally educated personnel.
Mm-hmm.
And that was done during that generalized field staff. A good deal of my time in the 60s was spent in the development of that generalized field staff. And that meant the development of region district offices in all of the counties. And we developed our district offices on a county basis. Mm-hmm. And then unifying those district offices under regional, in regional packages, so that we ended up in 1980 with five regional offices in Cape Breton, New Glasgow, serving the North Shore, and Halifax serving the central area, and Lunenburg and Bridgewater serving the South Shore, and the Kentville serving the Valley area, and in Yarmouth serving the Western area. Mm-hmm. And within each of those regions, districts under a district supervisor, and the staff in each of those districts, the whole departmental staff unified under one district supervisor,
mm-hmm.
all reporting to a regional supervisor, a regional administrator, and eventually reporting to a director of field services in Halifax.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like quite an accomplishment.
Well, it was fun. It was fun because it was the consummation, really, of what I'd started in 1940, finally seeing it coming to fruition.
Mm-hmm. One of the other things that you accomplished over the years that reflects your interest in long-range planning, I guess I first noticed when I read of reorganizing the department in 1962 to include a planning and research division.
Well, I suppose this goes back to my belief in the beginning, and when I went there in 1939 and 1940, the staff development was the be-all and the end-all. If one was to develop a highly efficient department with credibility and with efficiency. And one of the ways of doing that, of course, was the development of school social work, and the development of staff training, staff development. Another way of doing it, another aspect of it, was the development of a library, a resource center, where there would be reading material, periodicals, books, everything that would be needed in order to provide the tools and the facilities for staff training and staff development. We began very early to develop that. And that gradually led into the appointment in 1960 of a research officer whose task would be almost, well, solely planning with the deputy minister and trying to see ahead, to have not to be involved in the daily administrative process and the kind of things that happen to you when you go into the office in the morning at 8:30 and you're inundated with telephone calls and letters and requests from ministers and requests from politicians and so on, where 4:30 comes, 5 o'clock comes, and you haven't had time to think.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't had time to look ahead and say, now where's all this, where am I going to come out of the woods? Where is all this going to end? What's the end, what's the meaning of it all? And I felt very strongly that there should be some one person reporting directly to the deputy minister whose sole duty, whose sole responsibility would be to brood over this whole affair and not be weighted down with the burdens of administration and the involvement in daily management. And so we set that up, and it gradually, again, that was a gradual development. It started in with one person, mm-hmm. and then another person, and more were added, and I'm not sure how many there are now. I think there are probably a dozen personnel in that research and planning division. When I left it, there were around, I should think, 7 or 8 mm-hmm. personnel in the research and planning division.
Was it hard to sell that kind of idea to the legislators? You'd see more money going into planning and administration, and how did that compare with the amount that was going
into? I don't think it was harder, Karen. I don't think it was harder to sell that than it was to sell any of the other aspects of the department. This may sound like boasting, and I don't mean it to be that, but by the time by 1970, by the mid-60s or 70s, we had established two things that I had set out to establish. One was we were considered to be, I think, one of the most efficient. I'm talking now in terms of money and management. We were considered to be, which I was very proud of, one of the most efficient departments in the government in terms of Treasury Board, where if we said to Treasury Board, this is the way it is, that's the way it was. And Treasury Board didn't argue with us. Mm-hmm. Or if we said to the Department of Finance, this is the bottom line, this is the way it is, the Department of Finance didn't second guess us, as so very often happens with social work and welfare people, where you're second guessed by the Treasury people, by the finance people, who consider themselves a cut above the social worker. Mm-hmm. And I think we had succeeded by the mid-60s to have created, whether it was real or an illusion, we had created it. This image of the department, number one. Number two, we had created, I think, an acceptance at the political level, both with the liberal and conservative, both with the liberals and conservatives, an acceptance that we were compassionate. And we were humane, and we were understanding, and that if they wanted something, they had but to come to the department and they would get it, and they would be treated humanely and compassionately and with understanding. So the result was that budget-wise, money-wise, in getting things, I don't think that I encountered any more difficulty, Karen, in getting money for research and planning than I encountered in anything else. If we said that, you know, this is where we needed it, we would have gotten it. If it was available. Mm-hmm. But that was the larger problem, you know, of getting an increase in budget from year to year.
Mm-hmm. You're leading nicely into my next question. Thank you. The next question has to do with the federal developments that took place over those years, during the 60s primarily. Canada Assistance Plan, the VRDP, Medicare, Hospitalization, Young Offenders Act. A number of different pieces of legislation, which I think made things made funding more available for provincial governments. What was your involvement in the development of those pieces of legislation?
Well, I was a great admirer of R.E.G. Davis, Dick Davis, who was the executive director of the Canadian Welfare Council. Oh, I should think from the early 50s. I'm not sure when Dick went to the Canadian Welfare Council. But he was there in any event in 1957, when I referred to the fact the Unemployment Assistance Act had been passed in 1955, in the operative in 1956. And the council was committed, and Dick was committed, to doing something in the way of developing a comprehensive piece of public assistance legislation for Canada. And here was the beginnings of it, so to speak, the nucleus of it, the skeleton of it in the Unemployment Assistance Act. And Norman Craig, who later died, who was the head of the Public Welfare Division in the Canadian Welfare Council, was a very good friend, and we worked very closely together. I believe Davidson was still deputy minister. I don't think Joe Willard had come on the scene as deputy minister of National Health and Welfare at that time. It came later. But in any event, Dick persuaded me to go to Ottawa for a 3-month stint with the Canadian Welfare Council, the old Canadian Welfare Council. And we worked with Norman, and I worked with Norman, in coming up with a blueprint for a comprehensive model, the elements of a comprehensive model, public assistance legislation for Canada. We did that. It was exciting. It was fun. That was in the fall of 1957 it would have been. The changeover had just taken place from the Saint Laurent administration to the Diefenbaker administration. From that point on, from 1957 and 58 on, right through until 1965, the federal government, both liberal and conservative, had a very strong social welfare commitment. That was the era, remember. We got our hospital insurance program. We got the Canada Pension. We got the Canada Assistance Plan. Most of the reforms in old age security were brought about in that period. It was a fantastically exciting period. And I'm not sure when Davidson left, but I would suspect, my guess would be, that it would be sometime around 58, 59 that he went to Treasury Board, and Joe Willard, who was the director of research, came in. Well, Joe was a Joe was a wonderful person, one of the very great figures in social welfare, in the development of social welfare in Canada. Never fully appreciated. And that's a tragic story in itself, but he was not appreciated. But in any event, Joe, well, we were constantly thrown together with the federal officials at meetings, federal-provincial conferences of one kind or another. And it was truly, I don't know any better way to describe it than it was cooperative federalism, because the Canada Assistance Plan, which was developed in 1965, was not the way things are done now. They didn't do it the way we do it now. The legislation was enacted, but where it would lead, I don't think Norman Craig or Joe Willard or any of those who were involved with it knew precisely where they were going to come out of the woods. In principle, it was good, and that was sufficient. And it was enacted on that basis, it was sold on that basis, and it was accepted by the provinces on that basis. And then we entered into discussions. And Norman Craig would come down here, and Des Byrne, and the other federal officials that were involved with the planning, the social planning at the federal level, would come down to Nova Scotia, spend 3 or 4 days here. Now, what are your problems? And we would tell them what our problems were. And what is it that you want to do? What is it that you're trying to do? And we would tell them what it was that we were trying to do and where we wanted to go. And then 3 or 4 months later, we would find that regulations had been enacted and the path had been smoothed out, and we were assisted in going in the direction we wanted to go. Mm-hmm. And it was truly a cooperative effort between the federal and the provincial government, not the kind of thing that I saw beginning to develop in the late 70s, when we were it began in the days of in the regime of Marc Lalonde, when he was Minister of National Health and Welfare, when we were placed in an adversarial position. And it was not certainly a cooperative position as we had in the 60s. Mm-hmm. And much has been written about this, and I don't think any of it exaggerated. Mm-hmm. It was a glorious, wonderful period in the history of social welfare in Canada. Mm-hmm.
Also during that time, there were discussions about new constitutions, or a new constitution. The 1971 conference in Victoria considered social welfare issues as one of its major agenda items. Were you at all involved in that?
No, I was not involved in the constitutional end of it. I was involved in the issue, which I think was a central issue in those years. The issue of federal cost sharing. The fact that
we should turn that on.
That's all right. The fact that in 1956 the federal government became involved in cost sharing. I said earlier, this was not the recommendation of the Royal Sirwak Commission in 1939. The Royal Sirwak Commission had recommended against federal cost sharing in principle. Open-ended federal cost-sharing, of course, was an integral part of the Canada Assistance Plan of 1965. And I don't suppose Norman Craig or Des Byrne or any of those who had been involved in the development, or certainly I didn't, who had been involved in the development of the Canada Assistance Plan would see where it was going to lead them financially, or could envision what would happen financially eventually with the Canada Assistance Plan. Because it was open-ended cost-sharing. And while the provinces were slow to take advantage of the cost-sharing provisions, gradually, by 1971 or 1972, the provincial expenditures were mushrooming to the point where officials in the Treasury Board, like Mitchell Sharp, for example, who was involved with Treasury Board at that time, and others of the federal, of the Treasury Board types, were greatly concerned about the fact that here was a system of federal grants to the provinces which were open-ended, over which they had little or no control, and for which they got little or no credit politically. And I recall being at a federal-provincial conference in the early 60s. The first voice that was raised against it was Manning in Alberta, understandably, because Alberta was then becoming oil-rich and having a lot of revenue, and they didn't have to worry about cost-sharing like we did down here in Nova Scotia, where cost-sharing was our lifeblood, mm-hmm. where there was no way that we could develop programs if we didn't have federal cost-sharing. And I recall Manning making an impassioned speech about this intrusion of the federal government into provincial affairs, this setting of priorities, because the moment that the federal government said, we will cost-share this, or we will cost-share that, then, I suppose, logically, you could argue that, in effect, did set a priority, because the citizen could say to the province, look, the federal government says it will share this, or it will share that, well, why then don't you take advantage of the cost-sharing? Mm-hmm. And Premier Manning didn't like that kind of federal intrusion into provincial affairs. Mm-hmm. And gradually the cry was taken up across Canada. Now, mm-hmm. Quebec had always taken that position for reasons of its own, for constitutional reasons and cultural reasons and educational reasons, where it felt that the intrusion of the federal government through grants and aid, and therefore through the setting of priorities, in effect, imposed an exterior set of priorities on the province. Mm-hmm. And they opposed it for other reasons, for cultural reasons. But in any event, that was my main involvement over those years, arguing and fighting for a continuing federal presence.
Okay. I'm wondering if we can just turn off the video for just a second. Would you mind turn the audio off too, if you want? We could resume a question that we were just discussing, Dr. Mackinnon. I wonder if I could ask again what you, in your view, what a professionally trained social worker can bring to the administration of public welfare that a person of another background might not bring?
Well, I should think the main quality would be a consistency of purpose. A consistency of direction and ideals. And I mean by that one would expect understanding and compassion from both the non-professional and the professional. But it seems to me that the non-professional has a tendency to become emotionally involved in the wrong places, and perhaps in coping with human misery and human problems, to become sympathetic when perhaps they should be less than sympathetic, to become overly emotionally involved, and so on. I would hope that the professional, the thing that distinguishes the professional from the non-professional, would be this capacity to be compassionate and to be consistent in being compassionate and understanding, and not inconsistent, not blowing hot and cold, not wavering back and forth, depending on the their own subjective analysis of the situation.
Again, in the area of public welfare, is that consistency of purpose, as it applies to the politicians who determine your future, as well as to the clients on whose future your involvement rests? Does it cut both ways?
Oh, sure, it cuts both ways. One of the, you know, you've touched on a very interesting topic, which I think somebody should write a paper on sometime. I've never been able to understand why social workers, professional social workers, that is, can, by and large, in working with clients, in having relationship with clients, be compassionate, be understanding, can make allowances for all the problems that are involved, for the background of the individual, the road over which the individual has traveled, and do so in an objective, understanding, accepting way. And yet, politicians are no different from clients. Members of the Legislative Assembly and MPs are no different from clients. But when they have to relate to an MP or an MLA or a politician, they become totally and completely judgmental. All of their social work principles are thrown out the window. And they revert to a non-professional way of dealing with the politician. And you have to be totally consistent here, I think. And as a matter of fact, the principles that you would apply in casework, you have to apply with a vengeance when you're dealing with the politician.
Yes, I can see the setting now as you walk in to do some casework on your friendly MLA.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I made it a rule. If I was out in the boondocks, I tried to visit the MLA. I tried to see the MLA. I tried to talk to him. And it didn't matter what, you know, if it was a Liberal government in power, you know, that you just cultivated the Liberal MAs, that's foolishness. You cultivate all MLAs. Because again, going back to the nonsensical remark that I made earlier, you know, be kind to your caseworker because someday he may be your minister. And the same thing with ministers, ex-ministers, that I quite unashamedly say I went out of my way over the years to cultivate the politicians that I work with. Mm-hmm. Because they were, in actual fact, my lords and master. They were the ones that determined policy, and it was only good sense to try to develop a good understanding and a good relationship with them.
Mm-hmm. Related to that, in the way in which social change in Nova Scotia comes about, you as a senior administrator played an important role. What was the involvement of citizens groups in promoting social change here?
Well, I referred earlier, Karen, to the fact that we maintained municipal government here. We didn't dispense with it as they did in New Brunswick. I made every effort during those years to maintain a liaison, a communication, and to assist the structure of the voluntary agency. And I still believe this intensely. I'm involved at the moment with the Senior Citizen Secretariat. And one of the main issues there is the development of social policies for seniors at the provincial government level. And I think we're at a stage now, looking ahead for the next decade or so, where with the budgetary situation as it is, with the economic recession as it is, I don't think that we're going to get large budgetary appropriations for programs for seniors. Mm-hmm. I think we have to look at the voluntary sector mm-hmm. and how we can develop and encourage the voluntary sector to do more. Now, that's going to require some encouragement and infrastructure mm-hmm. at the government, and money, government budget. But it's important, terribly important, and I've considered it important from the time I entered the department in 1939, mm-hmm. that the voluntary sector be encouraged. And that's not just with words now. It has to be more than words.
Should the voluntary sector, let me start again. We're in a period now of constriction and restraint. Is there a role for the voluntary sector besides providing services?
Well, the other role, of course, is the role of activism, and that, you know, of pushing for new things, pushing ahead the social reform, pushing ahead the social frontiers, and that's always been there, and I assume that it's always will be there. With a good voluntary agency that knows where it's going and knows what it's doing. I think there are, certainly in the field of aging, and I'm 4 years out of the other fields, but certainly in the field of aging, there are large areas, sectors, where I question very much whether either the provincial or municipal government can do the job effectively that needs to be done. Now, there will have to be a very considerable amount. Well, I'll give you an example, the kind of thing I'm talking about. The question of home care for the aged, which is it's a central issue at the moment here in Nova Scotia. It is in most of the other provinces, I understand, too, or has been. Sure, nursing care, physiotherapy, rehabilitation, that kind of thing has to come from the Department of Public Health. It has to be done by professionals. Homemaker services, certainly. It's right and proper that that should be done through the machinery of government and financed through the machinery of government, as it is. But there are other services. For example, the matter of very simple thing, telephone reassurance. Mm-hmm. Old people are lonely. Perhaps if you were to single out the one central problem that affects old people today in Canada, it's loneliness, isolation, insecurity, the sense of being cut off, that you're out of the mainstream and you don't account for anything anymore. Well, there's a tremendous, and it's been demonstrated here in Nova Scotia, in specific single programs, a tremendous amount of good can be accomplished with the telephone by simply having a volunteer call on the phone once a day. Mm-hmm. How are you getting along? How are things? And so on. Mm-hmm. Is there anything you need? Is there anything I can do for you? And so on. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's the kind of thing that you can finance through a government program. Mm-hmm. I don't think that you can have that directed through a regional office and a group of social, or a district office and a group of social workers. Mm-hmm. That's a role for the volunteer. So that there are jobs that are singularly suited for the volunteer mm-hmm. in the field of aging. And I could go on and list that, Sonny. Mm-hmm. I picked that one out.
Mm-hmm. I'm sensing sort of an evolution here, thinking back what you were telling me about when you first came into the field, about how you knew what you were going to do, or had a sense of what you were going to do, and you knew that it was possible to do it. Do you feel that way today?
Well, How shall I put it? I think when I was just very young, when I came to the department, 27 years of age, two extensive stints in university, I felt that government could, and this was particularly true of the teaching that I had at the University of Chicago. It was particularly true of that era and of the New Deal, in which I was indoctrinated at the University of Chicago, that government could change the world, and that we had a commitment to change the world, and that government could do it. Now, my views have changed on that, and it's not that I'm frustrated or disillusioned, it's just simply that I've come to the conclusion that has to happen, yes. There's a role for government. There's a tremendous role for government. And there's much that government can do. But there's also much, I think, in 1984 that I didn't realize in 1940 that government can't do. It can never do. And there are some of these things that, you know, I've illustrated to you a moment ago that we have to do for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And that there's much satisfaction, there's much pride, there's much dignity in doing them for ourselves. And, you know, I think one of the, maybe people like me have been responsible for creating this atmosphere. I don't know. But there is an atmosphere abroad today, certainly in Nova Scotia, where the government should do it. The government should do it. Let's get the government involved in this. Yes, for many things, that's right and proper. For example, I don't think you can have voluntary effort without an infrastructure. And I don't think that the citizen will pay for the infrastructure. I think government has to pay for the infrastructure. But there's a whole area of activities that we could do for ourselves, and we shouldn't be looking for government to do them for mm-hmm. us. And they'll be done better if we do them ourselves.
If you were beginning today or tomorrow,
yeah.
beginning again as a person just fresh out of school, where would you start, knowing what you know now?
I would start with precisely the same two things, with people, with the personnel, with two primary thrusts. One, to surround myself with good people, with a good morale, who had a sense of destiny and a sense of belief in where they were going and what they were doing, number one. And number two, I would try to do what I tried to do from the time I entered the department in 1940, try to create an atmosphere of credibility that looked, you know, look at us, we're going somewhere. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. you believe in us because we're good and you can afford to believe in us and we won't let you down.
Mm-hmm. That kind of trust. As we're moving toward a conclusion now, again asking you to take sort of a retrospective view, could you summarize the kinds of changes that you've seen since you first came into the field in 1937?
Well, I think if you want me to put it in a paragraph, my successor, I think what he faces today in 1984, as compared with what I faced, if you want me to try to phrase that, I would see it thus, that what confronted me in 1940, 1939, when I came in the department, the things that we had to do, they were easily understood, at least they were easy for me to understand. They were easy to grasp. They were solid, substantial things. Like legislative reform, like improving personnel. You could delineate them, you could define them, you could, the giants that were there on your path, they were readily identifiable. There was no problem in that. The problem was to how to go about it, you know, how to slay the giants that confronted you. But identifying them was no problem. I think it's much more difficult today, that if I had to go out today, I would find it difficult to identify, you know, the paths, the directions. The giants are there today. They may be more formidable in 1984 than the giants that were there in 1940, but they're harder to identify. They're harder to come to grips with because the institutions that we've created are larger. They're harder to understand, more difficult to understand, more difficult to cope with. And I suppose it's this difficulty that is so frustrating to young people coming out of high school and coming out of university that are facing this kind of thing, whether it's the peace movement or whether it's unemployment or what have you. Sure, it's there, but how can I grapple with it? How can I get a grip on it to do something about it? We could not only identify it, but it was right there in front of it, and there were all kinds of ways of getting a grip on it and getting a handle on it and coming mm-hmm. to grips with it. And I didn't have that sense of frustration, and I don't think my generation had that sense of frustration. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So that's the change that you...
That would be the change that mm-hmm. I see.
I wonder if, in closing, there's anything you'd like to say that you might have said earlier, something that I might not have asked you that I should have.
No, I don't. I don't think so. I think we've covered the waterfront.
Okay. Well, in conclusion, then, I'd like to say thank you very much for spending time with us this afternoon, sharing your recollections and your memories. It's been very informative for me.
Well, it's a lot of fun.
Thank you again. It's much appreciated.
Okay.